evening.
Good evening.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. I hope that everybody is doing well. I know I am. Thank God.
Amen.
I'm very excited. I'm very excited because God is good and He continues to show me His love and how much He cares for me. And, you know, I don't have to be worried about anything because I know that he'll take care of me all the time.
Amen.
Kelly and I started taking a financial class about 3 weeks ago. And it's a class that is based on biblical principles on how to handle your money God's way. And I knew some of the things that this guy teaches previously, and I kind of been doing some of the stuff that he recommends that people would do on how to handle their money and whatnot. And I saw some changes happening in my finances, but one of her best friends, who also happens to be her financial planner, told her that we should take the class and not just read his book. So we signed up, and we've only gone for 3 weeks. This is a 9 weeks course, and at the end of the last session, which was this past Monday, I came out of that place and I was like so amazed with all these things that he was teaching on things that you should do. And we had an assignment to do, which I already completed, but it's not due until next Monday. And we had to go home and use two of the forms that they have, and you had to create a budget for the whole month, and then you had to break it down by pay periods and everything. So I was sitting there last night, writing all the numbers, starting with your tithing, then your savings and all that, and I'm writing numbers in there, and in my mind I'm thinking, man, I'm gonna come short. And I keep putting the numbers in there that he tells me to put. And at the end, when I had already accounted for everything that I was gonna pay and everything that I was gonna save and set aside for different things, I still had $86 that I had to allocate somewhere. And I'm sitting in my chair, I'm getting goosebumps, and I'm just laughing. I'm like, I cannot believe this, you know? Doesn't make any sense. So I rearranged the numbers again. The point is, I had to take it to a zero budget. Every cent that I get paid needs to have a name and a last name and accounted for.
Uh-huh.
And that's what you're gonna stick for the month. And I did that, and I was like, wow, so impressed. Then I move on to the next form, and I'm doing it for pay period. And I got it to work, and I was really excited. And I've been on this high since yesterday. I cannot believe this, you know? So I started thinking that this is just the wisdom of God manifested into a piece of paper, and He's showing me this is what you have to do. And even though you're thinking and you're worried, you're gonna come short. You're not gonna come short because I got you.
Amen.
So, Proverbs chapter 4, verses 6 and 7, it says, "Do not forsake wisdom, and she will protect you. Love her, and she will watch over you. The beginning of wisdom is this: get wisdom. Though it costs all you have, get understanding." I'm so thankful that when I say, "God, give me wisdom to do this," right away, He does it. And I don't have to worry about anything, and I know that I can just sit there and write the numbers down and have no doubt in my heart that everything's gonna work out the way it should, because He's guiding me all the way through. And I'm very thankful that He gave me such an amazing woman, that she's very wise as well, and we look at things the same way, and we both have the same goals, and we're working on this together. And this is what I've always wanted, you know, a person that is with me, by my side, not in front of me, not behind me, not coming against me. And he answered my prayers. So
praise the Lord.
He gave me what I asked for, and he gave me wisdom, and all of these good things are happening, and I couldn't be happier.
Praise the Lord.
So.
Praise God.
Any prayer requests or testimonies tonight, James?
I really have never done this. I know that I've been a member of Team Jesus prayer group. Didn't realize how God really works. They had some lady named Carrie, and I suppose she was like in her 30s or so. And like I said, we've had this Christian thing on Saturday nights, and I was up there playing my snare drum, the usual, you know, and she didn't do two bites for me to get out of there. She was kind of bewildered. Hatfield came over and knew me, you know, and went over and prayed with her, and I so naturally, I don't normally do this, but you guys have been talking about plead the blood of Jesus, so I plead the blood of Jesus over her, and prayed for her, and Tim prayed for her, and within another week later, she's now got contacted by Jackie, and is a member of Team Jesus, and that, I didn't think that would ever happen, so that's a praise report for that lady, because she was really bitter. That is big for
glory. Praise God.
Yeah.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yeah. I can believe it. I know God's powerful, but that's something else.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. Amen. Tim.
Yes, I want to thank the Lord for how he answers prayers. Tonight, Leah's back was really hurt, really bad. I mean, she could barely move, and it's great that you can pray one for another.
Yeah.
You know, when you can lay hands and pray, and I mean, I called home, and I mean, today she's just perky, and you know, and you realize that God had done. I mean, it was because she couldn't hardly move the other night.
We helped her pray move from the third floor onto the first floor.
Yeah.
And I was carrying boxes and all went to my back. And I laid on the floor with my feet up, and it helped a lot. And I prayed to God.
Thank the Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Praise
Amen.
The Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
That was just awesome.
Prayer.
Yeah. Prayer was answered, because you can pray and thank the Lord for
thank the Lord.
Being able to be here tonight. And then also ask for prayer. Monday we have a new instructor starting because one of them's going to retire, one of them been there, and I'm going to work with him a lot next week. And I always, you know, I pray for those things because they come in, you know, they're a little nervous, and you know, and I just pray that, you know, everybody, you know, we can hit it off well and do the teaching, because I realize when you're new, you know, you want to be part of the group, and I just ask God for wisdom and be able to have a new employee coming in to us. And also, I want to thank, I had a former student come by. I'm always thankful when they just take the time and search you out when they come by. You know, they'll bring the trucks by or something, and we'll take a picture of them. And when they come, just to tell you that they appreciate what you've done for them.
Yeah.
You know, I think that just shows a grateful heart.
Yeah.
I just realized that, you know, now they got a career, now they can make a living for their family.
Mm-hmm.
And when they take the time, I just thank God every time they do that. He wanted me to give them a big hug, you know, and I just thank God for the opportunity to invest in their lives, and I thank God for the people that invested in me to get me where I'm at. So I just wanted to thank God.
Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
You know, and speaking about praying for one another, this girl started working in my team in the middle of February, and she got picked to be in this council in the business that she's going to work on a project with some other people and all that. And I went to her desk to talk to her about something, and I said to her, the reason why I came, and she said, in a very nervous way, to pray for me? And I said, yeah, you want me to pray for you? She's like, no, it's okay. No, seriously, I can pray for you right now. Oh, no, that's okay. I know she was really nervous because this is something that involves the president of the business and all of that, and she's never been involved in something like that. I did pray for her, but when I went back to my desk, I wish I would have actually done it right there at the moment, because I know that even though this request came kind of like as an icebreaker type of thing to relieve the tension, I knew she really wanted that. And she knows that I'm a Christian. She is as well. But I think it really took a lot out of her to ask me that, because we've never actually discussed anything regarding our beliefs. We've talked about churches and all that, but not too much. So the next time that an opportunity like that happens, instead of just questioning the motive, I'm just going to write ahead, do it, because I know it's a true request. And if something like that happens to you, just do the same.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
How you doing, John? Anyone else? Okay. Let's stand tonight. Let's come to the Lord. Father, we thank you for bringing us here together. We thank you, Lord, for everything that you do for us, for all the blessings, Lord, for giving us your wisdom, a wisdom that is not of this world, Lord. That you gave us so that we can continue to walk down this path and see things as you see them, Lord. We thank you because you have given us your Holy Spirit, the Spirit that reveals to us the truth of your word, that give us the message that you want us to receive, the message that you want us to share with other people so that they come to know and see who you are. We thank you, Lord, for giving us the opportunity to pray for others. When they ask us, or when you put it in our hearts to pray for someone else, we thank you for giving us that opportunity, because we know that it is your Spirit that is working within us to reach this person that is making this request that you're putting in our hearts. We thank you, Father, because you are good. Thank you for all the promises that you have made, for giving us your healing, for making us prosperous, calling us your children, Lord. Thank you, Father, because everything that we have and receive is from you. For every good and perfect gift comes from above. We thank you, Father, because we know that you never turn your back on us. You're always there with open arms waiting to receive us. We come home to you, Lord. You gave us your Son to come into this world to die for us, to become sin in human form, Lord, to die for us. features that Facebook has now is that it shows you your past, and it tells you what you did on that day, 1, 2, 10 years ago. And 2 years ago today, I posted a quote of something that you said, Pastor, and you said 2 years ago that you cannot have grace for others unless you have grace for yourself. So,
amen.
I remember those words, and the first time that I heard that when you said it, it was really powerful to hear that, because it showed me that you have to learn to love yourself the way that God loves you, so you can show other people the same. So, all right. Announcements. Please turn off your phones. Any business that you have to attend to, do it before church or after.
Hallelujah.
All right. Let me see. Yeah, mine's turned off. All right. I got to practice what I preach, right?
Yeah.
All right. Okay, and this Friday, Eastern Gate House Prayer. It's going to be good.
Yeah.
I can feel it. Just releasing His presence.
Learning how to release the kingdom that has been placed within us.
Yeah.
Amen. We go out the streets like the 5,000 did on the day of Pentecost, or the 121 out, you're going to see the tenfold, hundredfold reaping. Amen.
Man, it's going to be good. All right, well, let's speak the word tonight. Would you not revive us again? That your people may rejoice in you. I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body
up your name, Lord. Worthy, 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 worthy. Yes. Yes. Oh, you are God of the heavens and God of the earth. You are God of the saints, worthy man. You are God on the cross and God over hell. You are God over man, be God when he fell. Heavens and God of the earth. You are God of our Savior's holy man. You are God on the cross and God of hell. You are God before man and God when he fell. God in what seems like happenstance. You are God in every circumstance. You are God when we fall and God when we stand. You are God who holds us in your hand. God in what seems like happenstance. You are God in every circumstance. You are God when we fall and God when we stand. You are God who holds us in your hands. Yes, Lord, you. God. It's all about you, Lord.
Yes, Jesus.
It's all about you, Lord. It's not about us, Lord.
Jesus.
It's all about you, Lord.
Jesus.
It's all about you, Lord. Release your kingdom, Lord. Through your servants, Lord, your word will never come back void. As the teaching and the preaching of the word comes forth in this place, Lord, let it go from your throne. Through your servant, Lord. Through your beloved ones, Lord, to go beyond these walls, you alone are worthy, Lord. Your grace is sufficient, Lord, it's done it all. You rent the veil, Lord, and no man, no religion, no doctrine, no teacher can ever put it back together except in our minds. Renew our minds. Release your kingdom. Let the wind blow, Lord, the sound of a mighty rushing wind that comes through the veil that's been torn, the sound of wind and the fire falling down and burning from your people, Lord. The burning river of oil of anointing and kingdom fulfilling your purpose and plan, O Lord. Let your holiness flow, Lord. Let your holiness flow forth. Let your holiness flow forth. Let your kingdom come. Oh, come. Through
we love you tonight. So grateful, Lord, for your presence. So grateful for your faithfulness to us, Lord, in every area of our life. So many of the things that's already been said here tonight, Lord, that when we're not even aware of what you're doing, but you are. You're there in the midst of us, moving, establishing your truth in our lives, Lord. As we look to you and believe in you, it manifests. And we give you the thanks and the praise for all of it, Lord. And we do it all in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. Praise the Lord. God bless you. You may be seated. Thank the Lord. Thank you, worship team. Thanks, Roberto.
Amen.
Again, thank you, everybody, for sharing your testimonies and prayer requests. Praise the Lord. I want to just say a few things here, and I always hesitate to do this because I'm not like real comfortable with this. Some of the stuff, most of it you've already heard before, and I don't want to bore you with old news, but I want to preface what I want to talk to you about here, and I'm going to be brief tonight. I have quite a few scriptures, but I want to just use the scriptures to speak for themselves, but Mike was talking about releasing the kingdom. Roberto was talking about praying for people at work. And Tim, likewise. And I just want to say that from the very beginning, and long before I understood much about grace, other than I knew I was saved by grace, but I still thought there was a lot of stuff that I was required to do in order to maintain that grace, I guess. But God has always been good, and I just want to say, I want to say it in the right way. I don't want to make it sound like this isn't about me, okay? And I really mean that. I know we say that stuff, but I'm serious. But I've seen two people raised from the dead that I prayed for. We've seen many, many miracles, Sally and I. Sally prayed for my sister 20-some years ago when she had a huge mass. And she had just come from Iowa City before Sally prayed for her. She went back the next day, and it had shrunk from the size of a melon to the size of less, smaller than a golf ball. She lived another 30 years practically after that, 20-some years after that, before she had cancer, came back in another area of her body, and eventually she succumbed to it. But then we had a little boy that was, I was pastoring in Ankeny years ago, it was right after we came up here from Texas, had one leg that was, I forget what it was now, an inch and a half or something shorter than the other one. He was just like 3 years old, just starting to walk, but he could barely walk. He had to hold on to things all the time because of the awkwardness of it. Obviously, just learning to walk, and then on top of that, have this. Prayed for him. The leg grew out in that service, and he ran out the door whole. I'm thinking of different things, and I don't want to just go over and over things. Just recently, I prayed for a gal in Ankeny that works for the man that does my dry cleaning, and she was healed of Crohn's disease.
Glory.
I haven't mentioned it, but I found out about it a couple weeks ago, and I haven't really talked about it. The other day, he asked me to pray for him. He had his aunt and two of his cousins died in the same week, and he was devastated. I could go on and on. I just don't want to sound like this isn't about me. But I'm saying, the reason I'm saying this is, I didn't really have any sense of, like, God's really going to do something today.
Right.
It's just, God is doing something all the time.
Yes.
And he's just wanting us to participate.
Yes.
It isn't because... Certainly isn't because I'm any more spiritual or any deeper or anointed or anything else than anybody else. It's not true. It can't be true because we all have the same spirit. We all have the same anointing. It's Jesus is the anointed one, and we have him. It's just a question of our awareness or our willingness to act on those things.
Mm-hmm.
And there's been, God has spoken to me in dreams. I acted on the dream. As crazy as the dream seemed, I acted on it. And God spoke to me through it and showed me things. I can't tell you how many times God has met our needs over the years. When there was just no way, just like what Roberta was talking about, if you put paper to pen, you'd come up negative. And yet we still had money. God still provided. God still made a way where there didn't seem to be a way. And so I could go on and on with specifics, but I'm not going to, just because I want us to realize this releasing the kingdom that Mike talked about. The kingdom is in us.
Yes, it is.
And we simply release it by being us.
Yes, exactly.
Yes.
Wherever we are.
Exactly.
And it isn't a religious thing. It's like Tim was talking about. From what I gather, you're not thinking about this in religious terms. It's just, it's what God has given you, you're giving to somebody else, and it's a blessing when it comes back. It's God's working on both ends, as my pastor used to always say. He always deals on both ends of the deal. It's never a one-way street with God. And I've been so excited and how God has done things. Nobody has been more shocked and, you know, kind of nonplussed by the things that God has done in my life and than me.
There you go.
But I just wanted to preface what I'm going to talk to you about tonight with that. And like I said, I could literally give you hundreds of incidences where God has done miraculous things. And simply because God is God. Because that's who He is.
Exactly.
And here, I don't generally go out of my way to pray for people, because I've seen that in my history of how I was taught when I first got saved. It was always about the minister, always about the pastor, always about, you know, some certain individual. And I've learned over time that God isn't particularly pleased with that. I mean, when we take this dynamic giftings of God away from the people of God, we diminish God. We limit God to a few people instead of multitudes of people. And obviously, you're everywhere. You're on your job. You're in your home. You're interacting with these people. You're doing different. That I'm not there.
Sure.
You're the only one that's there.
Exactly.
You're the vessel that God wants to use. You are Jesus in that situation.
Amen.
And in that circumstance.
Amen.
The question becomes, and this is why I think grace is so important, is because it helps people to understand, I can be used. I've got flaws. I'm not perfect, but God can still use me. God will use me. God wants to use me. He wants to be shown mighty through weakness. He wants people to see Him through us.
Amen.
Through earthen vessels. So let's get right on into this. Ephesians chapter 3, verses 17 through 19, Roberto. Ephesians 3, 17 through 19. And God does it. He doesn't do it so that I can feel good about me. He doesn't even do it so somebody else can feel good about them. He does it so that they can experience His love. The people that we're reaching out to, the people that we're praying for, the people we prophesy to, the people that we speak into their lives, the people that we interact with, God wants them to know how much He loves them.
Yes.
He heals, He delivers, He does all of that because of His love, because of who He is, right? So that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye being rooted and grounded in love may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth, the length, the depth, and the height, and to know the love of Christ which passeth knowledge, that ye might be filled with all the fullness of the God, all the fullness of God. I was going to say all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, but in Jesus. So the truth is, you don't know what you don't know. Now that's a revelation, I'm sure, for everybody, but that's a fact. We don't know what we don't know. Or we'd know it, right? And the same is true of spiritual awareness. Amen. We don't realize how spiritual we are. We're not aware so much of the time about the fact that God deals with us as spirits. We are spiritually alive. We are spiritually in connection with God. And so much of the time, we don't know it.
Exactly.
Right.
Now, we may not understand this, but Paul's telling us to search the deepness of God's love.
Yes.
And to the depth that we have spiritual vision to see the love of God, to that depth we will be filled with the fullness of God.
Yes.
So to just say it in a different way, when you're in a situation and there's somebody there who needs prayer, how are you going? The way you search the depths of God is by expressing the love of God to somebody.
Yes.
You may not feel all that lovable that day. You may not feel like being lovey, but God always is feeling that way. And if you can just be aware that God is working all the time.
Yes.
He's moving all the time, and we're not aware of it.
Yeah.
Just like we don't know what we don't know, we're not aware of the fact that God is always reaching out to people. God is always wanting to minister all the time. Not just when we're in the groove, you know, not just when we're in the spirit, or not just when we're aware of it, all the time. If we became aware of His presence, of His desire to minister all the time, imagine what could be done. Because we're only hitting occasionally. No matter how great that might be, imagine what it would be if we were constantly aware of God's love and His desire to love other people through us. To minister to them, to heal them, to deliver them, to give them hope, to do whatever it is that they might need at a given time. Amen?
Amen.
So let me look at a couple of scriptures here. Habakkuk chapter 2 and verse 4. But God, who is rich in mercy, for His great love wherewith He loved us. That's not it. Praise the Lord. Habakkuk 2 and 4. Habakkuk.
Ephesians 2:4?
No, Habakkuk.
Oh, I thought you were saying back to...
No. Sorry. I know. My Hebrew isn't the greatest, so just deal with me. Praise the Lord. I do like lox and bagels, but that's, you know, after that I have a problem. Praise the Lord. Behold, his soul which is lifted up is not upright in him, but the just shall live by his faith. Now, you don't have to go there, but because we're going to go to Acts chapter 13 here. If you want to go there, Acts chapter 13, verse 41. In Habakkuk chapter 1, verse 5, he says the same thing that they're going to quote here in Acts chapter 13, which is, God's working and we don't know it. And this is Acts chapter 41. Actually, they're quoting here from Habakkuk chapter 1, verse 5. Behold, ye despisers and wonder and perish, for I work a work in your days, a work which ye shall in no wise believe, though a man declare it unto you. Now, this is the way that the Message Bible says it. I'm doing something right before your eyes that you won't believe, though it's staring you in the face.
Uh-huh.
So God, we think God's only doing things when we hear about it. Right? I mean, when somebody, thank God we have testimonies. Well, I don't know if we'd know God was doing anything, right? I mean, that's one of the reasons why we have testimonies, because we need to be reminded God is working. God is doing things, and He's doing it through normal, regular people that have a relationship with Him. The truth is, though, God is doing something constantly, whether we know it or talk about it or not. He's always working. What He's looking for is a vessel. He's looking for somebody that can manifest that thing that He's doing. In fact, we could even say that He's already done it all, but it hasn't manifested in this world yet. His word's settled in heaven. It needs to be settled here, and the only way it gets settled here is for us to act on that word. Praise the Lord. So God is always doing stuff, not just when we hear testimony, but all the time. He's always active. Praise the Lord. So look, I got about four scriptures here real quick. In fact, let's back up for a moment. Go back in Acts chapter 13. And not back, but forward, I'm sorry, verse 43. Just a couple of scriptures here just to put this into context. And when the congregation was broken up, now this is, see, they're talking, they're preaching to these Jews who are very religious people, but have no miracle going on in their life, right? And so now when the congregation was broken up, many of the Jews and religious proselytes followed Paul and Barnabas, who, speaking to them, persuaded them to continue in the grace of God.
Yes.
Now, he just got through saying, God's doing something all the time, right before your eyes, and you're not seeing it. Praise the Lord. And then he goes on to say, just hang in here. You religious people, you Jewish people that are not seeing a lot of miracles, just keep in here. And he speaks to them and he persuades them to continue in the grace of God, not in their religious rituals. Right? Just believe in the love of God and the grace of God, because He's doing stuff and He wants you to be a part of it. Now drop down to verse 52. And the disciples were filled with joy and with the Holy Ghost. Now all it does is really talk about, they continue on teaching this grace message and how that God is wanting to minister and that God's doing stuff all the time, just if you could be aware of it. And just by sharing this, they're filled with joy and with the Holy Ghost. So the Spirit of God is moving, right? And just in them personally as well. So, all right, let's go on to John chapter 21 and verse 25. And I just picked out four random scriptures here. There's hundreds of them, but this is just because I don't want to take all the time. Amen. So, and there are also many other things which Jesus did, the which, if they should be written, every one, I suppose that even the word itself could not contain the books that should be written. Jesus was always working.
Yeah.
And he said, it's not me, but it's the Father that's in me. He does the work. So Jesus, if everything was written down about what Jesus has done in the supernatural, the miraculous, it would fill all the books in all the world, and it still wouldn't cover everything that he's done.
Yeah.
That's a lot of doing. Amen. That's a lot of activity that Jesus was involved in, right?
Mm-hmm.
All right. John 5:17. But Jesus answered them, my Father worketh hitherto, and I work. Father's working, I'm working.
Uh-huh.
He's working all the time. That's why I'm working. I know he's working, so I just act on the fact that I know he wants to work.
Right.
Anytime you're confronted with a situation, God's working.
Yes.
Just a question of whether I will work with him, whether somebody's going to work too.
Yes.
He said, I know. Basically, that's what he's saying. He's saying, my Father's working all the time. So that's why I'm working.
Right.
So I work because I know he's working. He'll back up what I do.
Exactly.
Praise the Lord. All right. Jeremiah chapter 1 and verse 12. Jeremiah 1 and 12. And nothing has changed. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. This is why God wants to do so much. So much.
Yes.
But he just needs somebody.
Yes.
That is aware of it, the fact that he's doing it.
Yeah.
Then said the Lord unto me, thou hast well seen, for I will hasten my word to perform it. I will hasten my word to perform it.
Uh-huh.
Praise God. I was watching today, a show on the Revolutionary War. And when Washington was trapped at one point, and I wasn't paying that much attention to it, but I think it was in Jersey, when they were in New Jersey, but I could be wrong about the geography of it. But nevertheless, they were trapped. The only way of escape was across the Hudson River into New York. And they crossed where the Brooklyn Bridge is now. Obviously, it wasn't there then. But there was no way of escape to the water because the English fleet was there. And the English army was on the other side, south, the English Navy was in the Hudson River, but further south. And the army had them trapped, so they couldn't get away on the coast. The only avenue of escape was across the river into New York. Well, the English Navy was coming up the river to block their escape, so they'd be trapped. And it would have been the end of the Revolutionary War. It would have been the end of any potential America.
Right.
And they kept repeating, it was almost laughable, but this is how unaware. And so they said, but nature showed up, and it got really, really pitch black that night, so that the moon was covered. It was totally black, so they couldn't see anything. And a great north wind came and kept those ships in the south because they couldn't sail. They were sailing ships, obviously. They couldn't sail north because the wind was coming out of the north, blowing them back down the river. So they couldn't blockade them and keep them from getting across the river. So here's two things already. I'm thinking, it's God. It's God. God brought this wind to hold that navy south so that they couldn't come up the Hudson River and block their retreat. And he overcast the moon so dark so that the army on the other side, which was only hundreds of yards away, couldn't tell that they were sneaking out, that they were escaping across the river. They got everybody across except the last 800 or so people, including George Washington, as the sun was coming up. They figured, well, they're not going to get away because the army's going to see them trying to get across. And he says, and then Mother Nature showed up again. And a fog came in, and totally, one of the guys had written in his diary, you couldn't see your hand in front of your face. And so the rest, that last part of the army, including George Washington, were able to get across the river and escape to safety into New York because of this fog. And I'm just saying, how many times God is doing stuff and people just aren't aware of it?
Sure.
You know, and those are just a little, you know, three examples. But God is working all the time. He's always working. We just need to be conscious of it. We just need to be aware of it. We just need to be willing to act. Just because we don't see him doesn't mean he's not doing anything. The only way anybody will see him doing something is if somebody does it, if somebody will step out and act on it.
Exactly.
Amen?
Yes.
Tim, if you didn't pray, my guess is you'd still be at home with your feet up.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? And I don't mean that. Lee, I'm not trying to be a smart aleck, but you know what I'm saying?
Yes.
It's easy just to think, well, you know, I mean, right? But God is moving. God was moving there. You can't tell me God doesn't love you, Leah, enough that he wants you healed.
Amen.
But somebody had to pray.
Exactly.
And it's this way in every situation, every area. He's always there. He's always wanting to do because he's always doing.
Amen.
It's just a question of somebody will step out. All right, Isaiah chapter 9 and verse 7. He's going to hasten his word to perform it. Isaiah 9 and 7, of the increase of his government and peace there shall be no end. The increase of his government and his peace there shall be no end. Upon the throne of David, upon his kingdom, to order it and to establish it with judgment and with justice from henceforth, even forever, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform it. His kingdom. He'll establish it wherever there is somebody believing it.
Exactly.
Righteousness, joy, peace, love. In the Holy Ghost,
amen.
Healing, deliverance, all of that is part of the kingdom.
Yes, it is.
Praise God.
Amen.
All right, Matthew 16, verse 18. It's so simple, you know. I mean, it's like I said, we don't know what we don't know. We're just not aware of what we're not aware of. Unless we focus on it. Unless we realize he's doing something all the time. He's always doing something. If I'm aware of it, then I can work with him. I can function the way that I was created to function.
Amen.
His kingdom can be spread. Amen. And I say also unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I'll build my church. And look at this. The gates of hell shall not prevail against the church. That's you. That's me. That's us collectively, but it's each one of us individually.
Amen.
The gates of hell, sickness, disease, poverty, all of that stuff comes from hell. It doesn't come from heaven, it comes from Satan. Satan comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. And the gates of hell shall not prevail against us.
Exactly.
As long as we're aware
exactly.
that they can't prevail.
Amen.
Because we're aware of Jesus.
Amen.
That comes directly, you know, he says, thou art the Christ, Son of the living God. God didn't reveal this to you, or the man didn't reveal this to you, but God, he was aware of God and what God was doing. Amen? So it shouldn't be any doubt that God is active. He's at work all around us. Praise the Lord. The thing about spiritual vision is the more we focus on ourselves and our circumstances, the more we lose sight of God. That's why the devil's always got us focused on us or the impossibility of the situation if it's somebody else. I mean, you know, you even hear sometimes people request prayer. None of you, honestly, none of you. But I hear it every once in a while, and somebody will request prayer, and they preface the request for prayer by a monologue about how horrible
right.
and impossible the situation is. Well, that's not exactly a faith builder. You know, I mean, like everybody dies from this and this is horrible and the doctors and they've, you know, written them off. Sometimes it's better to just say, let's pray. Don't even go into the details. Let's just say, hey, come on, let's pray. They need healing. God heals. Let's pray and God will heal them. Praise the Lord. Just leave all the negative stuff to the doctors. That's their job. That's what they do. Amen. So, you know, we need to be aware of God, not so much aware of the circumstance, but aware of what God is capable of. He's able to perform his word, and he will if somebody will believe it.
Amen.
It's about faith. And faith is in a simple way of saying it, is just God consciousness.
Yes.
A belief that God's able, God's here, God can do it. That's faith.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
So 2 Corinthians, and this is a fairly lengthy scripture here, but I think it's worth reading all of it. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 7 And then we're going to read right on through to chapter 4, verse 6. And let you, you can always go back and kind of reread this and meditate on it, but I want to establish this here. So 2 Corinthians chapter 3, beginning at verse 7, and we'll read right through chapter 4, verse 6. If the ministration of death, written and engraven in stones, was glorious, so that the children of Israel could not testify steadfastly behold the face of Moses for the glory of his countenance, which glory was to be done away, how shall not the ministration of the Spirit be rather glorious or more glorious? For if the ministration of condemnation be glory, much more doth the ministration of righteousness exceed in glory. For even that which was made glorious had no glory in this respect, by reason of the glory that excelleth. He's talking about the difference between grace and the law. For if that which is done away was glorious, much more that which remaineth is glorious. Yes. Seeing then that we have such hope, we use great plainness of speech. And not as Moses put a veil over his face, that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is abolished, but their minds were blinded. For until this day remaineth the same veil untaken away in the reading of the Old Testament, which veil is done away in Christ. But even unto this day, when Moses is read, the veil is on their heart. Yep. Nevertheless, when it shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. Now the Lord is that Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's liberty. Yep. Amen. Liberty to minister. Liberty to act. Amen. To function as the body of Christ. Without the sense of guilt and shame, and I failed here, I didn't do this perfectly. No. The power is there and it's available to us. Unlike it has ever been. Because you know, under the old covenant, there was only kings, priests, and prophets were the only ones that were anointed. They were the only ones that the Spirit would come on for them to act. Now we're all kings and priests. Everybody has this capacity in Christ. But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord. Aware, right? When we're aware of that, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. What is he saying? He's saying, we and these works and greater works shall you do, yes, amen, in my name, if yes, thou canst believe. Right. When we're aware, when we, with open face, beholding it as a glass, the glory of the Lord, amen, we're changed into that same image. Right. When we're aware of God, we're able to do the works of God.
Yes.
We'll act. Amen?
Amen?
Therefore, seeing we have this ministry, as we have received mercy, we faint not. Now, that's the proof of what I just said, because this is a continuation. We know that there's chapters in the Bible, but originally it was the codex, or the books were just continuous writing.
Yes.
It wasn't any of this until the King James Bible. So, therefore, seeing we have this ministry, but what ministry? The ministry of awareness of God causes us to act, and then God acts. Although God's acting all the time, right? So as we have received mercy, we faint not, but have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty, not walking in craftiness, nor handling of the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. And the manifestation of the truth. Truth, God, his power, his anointing, right? But if our gospel be hid, if this truth is hid, it's hid to them that are lost. In whom the God of this world has what? Blinded them, made them dull sense, unaware. Which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is in the image of God, should shine unto them. Praise the Lord. Amen. Think about that for a minute. This is about spiritual blindness.
Right.
It's not to put condemnation on you or to put guilt, it's to make us aware.
Mm-hmm.
How many people walked by Jesus unaware, God in the flesh, when he was here?
Right.
He was there, and they walked right by him, unaware. He was just another guy.
Right. Yep.
But the moment he acted, got their attention.
Yes.
And he said, the Father worketh, and I work.
Well,
that'll get somebody's attention. Somebody who otherwise is totally unaware of God, maybe doesn't even believe in God, God can become real to him in a heartbeat. Not just God's power, but the love of God for that individual, for that person who maybe has never experienced much love. Certainly not the love of God, because they don't know that he even exists. And Lord help us, we all know that there's precious little real love in this world anymore.
Right.
Just a lot of talk, praise the Lord. But amen. All right, Hebrews chapter 1, verses 2 through 4. Hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high, being made so much better than the angels, as he hath by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
That's who we have in us. Christ in us, the hope of glory.
Yeah.
Amen. We already know he's glorious. The fact that he's in us creates a hope for him to be glorified through us, for other people to experience him. Amen. Colossians chapter 1, verses 15 through 20. Again, it's about us being aware.
Mm-hmm.
If you're conscious of God, then as believers, when we know that God's working, we have confidence that we can work, that we can do something that's going to affect the situation that we're dealing with. Amen? So who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature? We're talking about Jesus. Who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature? For by him were all things created that are in heaven, that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created by him and for him. And he is before all things, and by him all things consist. And he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have the preeminence. For it pleased the Father that in him should all fullness dwell. And having made peace through the blood of his cross by him to reconcile all things unto himself, by him, I say, whether they be things in earth or things in heaven. And the scripture says in another place, just to put this in context, everything is subject to him.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Amen. And he in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead, and we are complete in him.
Yeah.
Yep.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Complete in him. I mean, we can do what he did if we're aware. He's telling us we're heirs and joint heirs, have the same inheritance. We've got a right to act, but we have to be conscious. You know, Proverbs 29 says that where there is no vision, and they're talking about where there is no redemptive revelation of God, people perish. And that's what he's talking about in Habakkuk. Where there is no redemptive revelation of God, people perish. That's why grace is so important. We need a growing vision of the redemptive revelation of God.
Yes.
Because if it's good for me, it's good for everybody.
Exactly.
If he did it for me, he'll do it for everybody.
Exactly.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Why? So that we can be ushered into his greater purposes for our lives.
Yes.
Right.
That's how it works. Awareness, consciousness leads to faith, which releases God's ability in the church. He's working all the time. Just a question of whether the church is working.
Right.
Ephesians 5, verse 14. I'll show you how simple this is. Wherefore, he saith, awake thou that sleepest, and arise from the dead, and Christ shall give thee light.
Yep.
Revelation. The only part we have is to live inspired.
Yeah.
That's all he's asking of us. Be inspired by this reality, by this truth. Awake and arise from the dead, and Christ will give you light.
Yeah.
Luke chapter 9, verses 33 to 35. Came to pass as they departed from him, Peter said unto Jesus, Master, It's good for us. This is on the Mount of Transfiguration. Most of you are familiar with these scriptures. That's why I cut it down to just this part. But it's good for us to be here. Let us make three tabernacles, one for thee, one for Moses, and one for Elias. Not knowing what he said. In other words, he didn't know what he was talking about, but he had to say something. So while he thus spake, there came a cloud and overshadowed them, and they feared as they entered into the cloud. And there came a voice out of the cloud saying, this is my beloved son, hear him. Which is why I get uncomfortable talking about what God has done when I prayed for somebody or in some situation or circumstance. Not that God's going to punish me or anything else, it just makes me uncomfortable. Because God is clearly saying here that it's not about men's or women's stories. It's about Jesus' story. And all of our stories point to his story. That's why we give testimonies. You know, I understand that. We're not testifying to our power. We're testifying to the goodness of God and the fact that he uses us to show himself mighty. So all of our stories point to him, to his story. Praise God. Abraham is the father of all the faithful, all those that have faith in the true God. Amen? His story was ultimately all about pointing at God's story. I mean, Isaac, type of Jesus. You know, he's going to crucify him. God provides a sacrifice. You see it over and over and over through the scriptures. All of the stories in the Bible are literally not stories about those individuals. They're stories that are pointing to his story, to Jesus, to God. Amen? So, Romans chapter 4, verses 1 through 5. What shall we say then that Abraham our father, as pertaining to the flesh, hath found? For if Abraham were justified by works, he hath whereof to glory, but not before God. For what saith the Scripture? Abraham believed God, and it was counted unto him for righteousness. Now to him that worketh is the reward not reckoned of grace, but of debt. But to him that worketh not, but believeth on him that justifieth the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness. So when we're aware, God works. It may look like we're working, but we're not working, we're just believing. And his righteousness or his power is released through us. Amen? So here's what I'm saying. Instead of focusing on what the world has come to, focus on what has come to the world. Amen? I mean, we see all the junk that happens in the world. We see what the world has come to, but we forget what has come to the world. What the world has come to is nothing. It's not a big problem. It may look like a problem, but what has come to this world is far greater than anything that this world's coming to. Because we've already read that he has power and dominion and authority over everything in heaven and earth and beneath the earth. It may look horrible, but he's still bigger than the problem. Yes. If we are aware, yes. The problem's not a problem. The problem is, are we aware of the problem solver?
Yes.
Praise God. So not on our circumstances or our stories, but on God's greater story. The greater truth. And then we'll see God happening right before our eyes and realize he's been happening all along. Praise the Lord. Psalms 105, verse 4 through 8, the last scripture here. Psalms 105, verses 4 through 8. Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his face evermore. Remember his marvelous works that he hath done, his wonders and the judgments of his mouth. O ye seed of Abraham, his servant, ye children of Jacob, his chosen, he is the Lord our God. His judgments are in all the earth. He hath remembered his covenant forever, the word which he commanded to a thousand generations. That would include us.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. He hasn't forgotten. He hasn't stopped. He's not taken a break. He isn't resting on some past experience. His covenant is forever, for thousands of generations. We are the seed of Abraham. We have a right to operate in this promise, in his promises. And God is saying, I'm working. Just wake up. Just be aware. God is at work. And when we believe in his love and in his grace, we see what has been there all along. Praise the Lord. Think about it. When we pray for somebody to be healed, they were healed 2,000 years ago. Somebody just has to see it and declare it. It's true with everything. He suffered those stripes for our healing. He became poor that we might become rich. We became rich 2,000 years ago. Somebody just has to wake up to that reality, has to realize it, and begin to speak those truths, those promises of God, into our lives and into one another's lives and into others' lives. Amen?
Amen.
Right before our eyes, God is working.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
That's faith. That's victory. That's glory. That's God working in us. Can you say praise the Lord?
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Give the Lord a hand clap. Praise the Lord. So it isn't what we don't know. It's what we don't know we don't know that's messing us up. Praise the Lord. So let's just be aware. Just try to remind yourself throughout the day. God's working. He's always working. When the enemy comes and tries to blindside you with things, God's working. So I work. My Father works, so I work. And God gets the glory. Hallelujah. And the creation benefits. The whole creation begins to see the manifestation of the sons of God. We groan for it. The whole earth groans for it. Why? Because it was created to be one with its creator. Hallelujah. And we're the ones that get the privilege of making that happen. Amen. God bless all of you. Have a great rest of the week. Try to anchor yourself to something so you don't blow away. Amen. And stay aware. Hallelujah. And see you back here Sunday. God bless you all. In Jesus' name.